Welcome, Park. Welcome, everybody, to our wonderful interview with our great guest today, Park Stickney from the United States, of course, living now, as we all know, in Europe. And I'm so happy that Park made time for us to be together for us for today's interview. Park, welcome. Thank you so much for your time.
Thanks for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. It's a little strange to watch a video of myself playing, but it's
I'm sorry, it was a little bit complicated because there was such a long biography to put into it during that video.
A video of me and watching things I've done. But it's okay. I assume it. It's okay.
It's perfect, like that you could have really, like, I mean, that your playing is so beautiful. I'm so happy that we have you today, and I'm sure that you will also share with us your music live. Mm-hmm. Because the harp is behind you, so I'm very sure. But Park, tell me, where are you now at the moment?
Right now I'm in Switzerland. I've been in Switzerland. I mean, I'm often traveling back and forth between New York and Switzerland, but since COVID, I've been in Switzerland all the time, in near Lausanne, in a small town of 200 or so people, 220 people, called Valeur-sur-Ursin. It's about 20 minutes from Lausanne on the lake of Neuchâtel.
Oh, that must be really nice. But how is the situation now in Switzerland? How did you survive this situation now?
I mean, it was okay. I mean, it was fine. Of course, it was complicated for many people and fatal for some. But for me, it was okay. It just meant that my life changed a little bit. I didn't travel around so much at all. But as for musicians, we sort of make up our careers anyway, as you know. So I found enough things to work on here at home. And so it was fine. It was really fine. Also because I've been traveling a lot, more than usual in the last couple of years. So I realized that it was almost a critical point where I needed to address all the, not just laundry, but laundry-like things that were cluttering up my office. So it's been actually.
You know, I have seen some of your live broadcasting during this period of time, and I was always so amazed of your improvisation and of your teaching. Actually, you were teaching also online, and I was just like really absolutely astonished by everything. And I wanted immediately to ask you, how do you all do all these things? But we can come into that. But before we'll come into this, maybe my questions about how you improvise, how did you start to improvise? How did you find out that you can improvise, if someone taught you to improvise, or if you have just find out by yourself that you can improvise, or did you start the harp right away, or did you play piano before?
Wow, that's a lot of questions. Okay, so the easiest question is, I started piano first. I started piano when I was 5, and then harp when I was 7. And I think about the improvisation thing, it's very interesting. The way you ask your question is, how did I learn? I think it actually, what happens to most people is they forget how to improvise, because I think we are born, all of us are improvisers. And then somehow the more we learn about music, I think there's a tendency for some reason to forget that we have this freedom, that we really can just do whatever we want. Maybe because we're trying so hard in our studying to achieve a specific thing. But we forget that that's just one specific thing out of many other possibilities, and we can just play. So I was improvising from the beginning, and I always think, I mean, this is the same answer I often give because people ask me this question. But I think it's because in a way I was a bad student. Luckily for me, I was a bad student. So in my first harp class, I was always fooling around and not doing what we were supposed to be doing, but doing my own thing. And I liked it. I always liked playing the harp. I didn't realize I liked it until much later. It was just a thing I did, but it's fun. The harp, as you know, the harp is a great toy. We can do lots of things with the harp. So I was always fooling around and getting in trouble for not following the lesson. It was only until later on that I realized that actually I was a responsible student, because I was doing exactly what I needed to be doing. I was really following my path from the beginning.
But you know what is very interesting? Because, of course, as a boy, that you started to play the harp when you were 7 years old already. How did you come to that? Because it's, I mean, girls, usually they want to play like a princess and so, but how you as a boy started to dream about the harp?
Yeah, I mean, it just happened. There's no great story. The story is that, I mean, I think that harpists are made when some harpist comes to their area and starts to create harpists. And then those harpists create other harpists. It's like, it's kind of like a pandemic in a way. But in my town in Mesa, Arizona, a harpist moved to town and she got some funding and she started a harp program in the schools. And so, and I was there, I think it was the first or second year that this existed. And the way that she went to each school and she showed the harps, and basically all you had to do was answer questions. Like, do you want to take harp lessons? And I thought, yeah, sure. Why not? Why, sounds like fun. And because I was already playing piano, and it was sort of, I mean, it's sort of like the piano in a way, although the longer I play, the less I think it's like a piano. But so it was always, it was very easy to start playing the harp. There was the school program, and so we had a group class. So I played in the group class in a library, and then
during But it was in the United States, right? It was
in Arizona, in Mesa, Arizona, uh-huh. outside of Phoenix. And the harpist's name is Karen Miller, who started this program. So I don't know if there's thousands, but there are many, because it's been around for a while now, and for a long time. So, and there, you know, probably there are thousands of harpists, because it's been, 40 years of this has existed. So, you know, anyway, and then during the school year, the harps would go to each school. So there'd be a troubadour harp at every school, and you can have harp lessons and go and practice. And so it was really easy to play the harp, because it was just there, and you could borrow the troubadour, take it home and practice. And then we had a harp ensemble as well. So apart from being a boy or being a girl, it just happened. It was never my dream to play the harp. And that's what you're referring to with the princess thing, is that some people dream of the harp. And I'm used to the same, that I meet people who think, wow, I always wanted, my dream to play the harp, so beautiful. But I mean, I was 7, so that summer, my summer activities were harp and swimming.
To interrupt you, sorry to interrupt, but I found this picture where you might be about 7 years old, what?
Then I would have been 10 years old then, but
10
yeah.
years old. Does anybody find him? I could not find. I only because he was stuck. Park was stuck. So I found him. Who was him? But I would never recognize him. Would ever anybody? Because we can have a comments. Can anybody find out who is Park?
That's funny. I mean, I feel like I haven't really changed that much. In fact, I still have that shirt.
That's very. Don't tell me. It's not easy, but maybe Park, you can tell us who you are.
Who I am in the picture?
Yes.
Okay, so I am in the second row from the top, and I'm the third from the left.
Indeed. In the blue, the third the one blue. On the left with the black hair. There is a girl with the pants, with the white pants, and then the second, the second boy after that girl. Yeah. How really cute. But you were the only one who played the harp at that class?
In my class, yes. In the school, no. But actually in the school, I may have been the only one. I don't know if I was the only one playing the harp in that school at that time. There was a different elementary school. I switched right when that picture was taken.
Because here is also another class, but it's already bigger. And here you can tell us also where are you in this picture?
So I'm actually in the same place, except second in. I'm moving a little bit more to the left. But this is Interlaken Arts Camp. Uh-huh. Did I send this to you? Is that how you found it?
No, I found it on the internet.
Oh, wow, that's crazy. Wow.
It was really, I was very happy to find some of the pictures years.
Really funny. As you see, I haven't changed there. I haven't changed now.
Absolutely not. No. Yeah. And you're, of course, as you said, your t-shirts are the same.
Yeah, exactly.
Park, did you start directly on the big harp or did you start on the troubadour harp?
No, I started on the troubadour harp and I switched. And that for me, I think is really interesting. I switched because of the first jazz and pop harp festival that Victor Salvi started in actually right at that time of that photo, the first one in 1978. And so I was playing, you had to make your own arrangements of pop songs. At that time, it was called this is important because it was the first international pop and jazz harp festival, not jazz and pop. But anyway. You would make your own arrangements, and one of my arrangements was Somewhere Over the Rainbow, and it was so chromatic with a lever harp that my teacher said, maybe you should switch to pedal harp. So I switched for that.
And
you, did you start with lever harp or pedal harp?
No, pedal harp. It was directly. No lever harp in our country. No, pedal, right away, pedal. Yeah. But you know, I feel like when you play now in these days when I see you and you have so many chromatics with the pedals, it seems like it's a piece of cake for you. It's absolutely nothing. You just do everything so naturally and there is no mistakes with the pedals. Absolutely. What is in your head going through when you play in that moment?
Wow, I like this question because it's like a compliment disguised as a question and a question disguised as a compliment. I don't know what's in my head. I mean, I've always, since I started the pedal harp for this that jazz competition, I don't know. Actually, that's not what I wanted to say. What I want to say is that at that very first harp festival is where I learned about the pedal slide, which I'd never seen before since I just started playing the pedal harp when I went there. And this really changed my life. I really was into this pedal slide. And maybe because I'd only been playing the pedal harp itself a little bit. So from the very beginning, I was doing melodic things with the pedals. And I had a very free approach, I think, to the pedals. And because I was also making my own arrangements. Because I think this is something I think about right now. I mean, a lot right now is that harpists who switch from lever harp to pedal harp, often they do it because the repertoire they're playing requires it, which was in a way the same thing for me. The repertoire required that I switch from lever to pedal harp. But the difference was it was repertoire that I was creating myself. I was choosing what notes I wanted to have happen. I mean, more or less the melody also chose some things. But I had a direct power over what was going on. And so I think that this connection with choosing what I wanted to play, the notes I wanted to play, having that interact with the pedals themselves gave me a more closer approach to the pedals in a way. And I think that's what happens now when I play with the pedals. And also because, I mean, I'm following always the things that I find interesting. I mean, I found the pedal slide interesting, and so that informed about my playing. And then because of that, I found this thing called fast sevenths, which is a way of playing all the dominant seventh chords, which is very useful for playing jazz. So this, I mean, my whole approach to the harp is based around the pedals. So I guess either my pedals, I mean, of course I don't think there's really a thing as mistakes, especially if you're improvising, but I sometimes am surprised by what happens. So I am surprised sometimes. It's not always exactly as I perhaps I am at ease with my pedals because I'm playing with them a lot and that really informs what I'm doing, or perhaps because I'm at ease with my pedals is why I'm playing music I play, or just who knows. But I do, I'm really into the pedals and always have been.
I must say, I'm always so impressed. I'm really impressed. And as I mentioned at the beginning, when I saw one of your broadcasting program during this pandemic time, I was really watching it with the open mouth because I was like, how he can do that? And it's actually, it seemed to be so easy when you explained. It was a chromatic scale somehow with the two pedals on each side, and it was just like I don't know. Maybe you can maybe show it now. Is it possible that you will show it to us? Maybe you know what I'm talking about.
I think I know. I could show you. Let me go to the harp camera, and I'll turn on the pedal camera.
So are you talking about, was it this thing, the 3-2, 3-2, 3-2? What was the, sorry.
Oh, that I have not seen. I have seen that it was like dee-da-dee-da-dee-da-dee-da-dee-da, and it was just like.
Was it this? Is it that?
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah.
That I have not seen. Oh my God, this is amazing. No, this I have not seen. This is crazy.
Well, you'll have to do that after the broadcast. I mean, luckily it's not so hard. It's just having the idea.
No, but how you think about it when you do it? How do you think? Because sometimes the mind goes slower than the fingers, and because the pedals must go really quick. How you manage? It goes more automatic. Well,
I mean, these are very friendly and nice questions, but you know that we musicians are constantly doing fast things, fast processes. With your hands, as you're dealing with your hands, the hands are doing very subtle and fast movements, and you practice them over the years. So you know the answer to your question is that, but the difference is maybe that because of the direction my harp life took, that it intended to involve the pedals more. But what I can show, I'll show you, I can do it like this. So, that's not good. I thought I could show you the pedals from here, but it's not going to let me do it. But actually, I do want to show you. So let me just make this happen.
Here's the pedals. Yeah, let's just show the pedals then.
Uh-huh.
So what I was doing was this 3 and 2. And this is a very interesting thing. Maybe this is the one thing I'll show you, or at least.
Wow.
If you do this with F, G, and A in the right tempo, wow, pay no attention to my falling apart shoe. This gives you, right, on the harp. Good. And then if I do the left foot, this gives you the other whole tone scale. Right?
Wow.
So, so the thing is, what's interesting about the whole tone scale, I can look at you here, is that the chromatic scale and the circle of fifths made up of whole tone scales. This is my right foot whole tone scale, which is this, and my left foot whole tone scale, which is this, and it's like this. So if I wanted to make a chromatic scale, I could do this. And I could slide it. If you wanted to.
That's crazy, fantastic. That's amazing. That's really amazing. But did you invent this by yourself? Did you come to this, that it works like that by yourself?
Well, that's a yes. Actually, yes, I had this realization about the whole tone scale is all based on this. And I had, and as far as invented, that's a powerful word. I realized myself that it was useful to use two pedals at the same time. Because I found, go back to the harp again, I realized that many times I was constantly, and I'm sure it's the same for you, that I was constantly having to do F sharp and G sharp very quickly, like that.
Yep.
And then I thought, well, maybe, and that's sort of dangerous because you could throw a pedal, you could have a problem. So then I thought, well, maybe it would be nice to hold them both down at the same time. And that seemed really dangerous. But I thought, well, maybe if I practice it would be less dangerous because now I'm controlling, at least it's a danger that I'm dealing with, like a chainsaw. The chainsaw is dangerous, but if you are very careful, and careful meaning putting your attention in the right place and knowing what the danger is, then it's not necessarily going to hurt you. It's the same thing with this. So I would, then I realized that the situations where I was doing this was often for a dominant seventh chord. And then I realized one day that you could do all 12 dominant sevenths using the same thing, doing different kinds of spellings. And then that's when I had the final realization about the whole tone scale, that I realized, because you're going right foot, left foot, as you're doing these fast sevens, as I call them, which is very useful for the jazz. And then I realized it's because they all belong to the whole tone scale. I mean, that's the thing about...
That's fantastic.
It all goes together. It's not, you know, it's everything's linked to something else.
I'm always so impressed. I'm really absolutely impressed by that.
Well,
absolutely.
You should do it. You should.
Go
and play. The secret is to not put the pedal in the notch, to go straight down and not go into the notch, and also to use sharps. That's it. That's the whole secret.
You have the perfect pitch. You have, probably. Yeah.
But it's not the answer. I have fast ears. So that allows me to know what I'm doing.
Yeah.
But you don't necessarily have to have it.
But I think it's very big help because you can imagine what tone you want to hear. When you push the pedal, you know what sound it will be like, you know. So I don't think that people who has not perfect pitch can really imagine so quickly what it will sound like when they will need to have really the imagination of the harmony very quick, but it's sometimes too slow for when you play fast.
I don't know. I mean, for me, I don't imagine so much what I'm going to play. It's more that I play and then I react to what I play. I mean, usually when I play, what I like to do is I like to just put my hands on the harp and just see what comes out. And then I know what I played. So then I can find it again. There it is. But it doesn't really matter. That's the thing about the harp, because it's this diatonic instrument. Even though it's fully chromatic, we only have, as you know, we have only these seven notes at the same time. So it's perfect for improvisation, because the improvisation, unlike on a piano, where you have access to all 12 notes all the time, then possible, even though there are no wrong notes, every one of those 12 notes has a relationship with what you're playing, but it's possible to get really into the weeds, to get really far away from something useful. But on the harp, those, you only have 7 notes, so it's hard to get too far away, to get too crazy. You have to really use the pedals and work at it too. So it's, yeah, I don't know. I think that I tend to just play, and then I can use my ears to help me steer where I want to go. But it's not that I imagine what I want to hear and then I make it happen. So in that case, and I think as far as knowing, you know, what you're talking about, it's about hearing what a pedal is going to do. I think that this is not a perfect pitch situation. I think this is just imagination. I think it's like any kind of muscle. I'm sure that anyone can hear a chord in their head. And you can hear a chord. You can hear a C major triad, if I say, right now. In your head, not sure. And so it's just about, and I'm listening to a C major triad in my head, and now I make it minor. And it's true, I can also feel, I was using it with an E flat, so I can feel my pedal moving that E flat, but I could also decide to make it with a D sharp, moving my left foot. But it's more, I think, being aware of the feeling in my head when I move that E to E flat to make it a C major triad to a C minor triad. I can feel, I mean, this might be crazy California stuff, but I can feel the feeling of the sensation I've had of that kind of concentration. And I think that this kind of concentration, this sensation, is something that we can work on. I think there's practices in the harp. I think when we practice, I mean, there's some physical exercise that happens, and there's a muscle memory thing. But I think what we're really practicing is we're really practicing our brains. That's why you can practice without a harp. That you can focus. It's easier because when you play it on a harp, you get a lot of oral confirmation of what's going on, and so you can tell if you're in the right, you know, in this, the notes you're playing give your brain a lot of useful information. But as far as listening to how things are, I don't think you need a harp, and I don't think you need perfect pitch.
Well, I think so, because for me, but anyway, these things, I'm thinking about the one question about the pedals, because many times I get the question why the pedals are set like they are, so that we have the B, C, D, and E, F, G, A. For the jazz, I think that because maybe you as using the pedals so much, you can maybe say that it has some kind of reason, because I think that as you can see also when you push them, that it's really equal, like from one side to another one. So do you think that when it has been the harp was made, that they thought about this, or is what is your opinion about the reason why the pedals are set like this?
I think they thought about the order, the circle of fifths, the order of sharps and flats, and they wanted to be able to add sharps and flats using the 2 feet as efficiently as possible. So you have F, C, G, D, A, E, or B, E, A, D, G, C, F, like this. I think that's what it was. And for me, for my thing with this, the whole tone scales, this is just a lucky accident that they could have, because they could have tuned the harp, they could have changed the order of the pedals in it any way, and they could have tuned the bass key of the harp in it any different way. It didn't have to be in C flat, just like in the single action harp, when they're tuning it in E flat major or sometimes in A flat. These are all choices, and with a single action harp, it's interesting because you only have 8 keys that you can play, right? If you go from E flat major to E major, you're missing 4. That's why they needed the double action harp, to have those missing 4 keys. That's what I think it is.
Yeah, well, we have a great comment from Miriam Serfas, which I say hello to her. Hello to you as well, Miriam. It's wonderful to see you, because you will be also one of the guests. And she wrote really nice messages, but she wrote also this, which I totally agree, that Park has a computer in the brain, which is really absolutely true.
Yeah. I would like to say that.
I would guess it is true, because for you it seems to be easy, but I don't think that you can, of course, practice. I'm sure you can practice, you can learn it, but for you, in your case, it seems to be so natural, so like you were born like that, you know. So
well, I've been it for a long time also. That's part of it. And I think because I'm playing a lot of my own music, so I'm really following a specific path, which I don't know what this path is necessarily, but looking back, I can see, I'm playing improvised music. And now I realize how much I like the pedals. So, yeah. So it's not a surprise. But anyone can do it.
But you started also to not only play the jazz music when you were little, but you were really studying the harp as a classical harpist, or
yeah.
What was your education going on?
Yeah. I followed a normal classical harp education with Carol McLaughlin in Arizona, and then with Nancy Allen, who was one of your guests I saw, and Juilliard. So you know, I'm working with Fabrice Pierre and Sylvain Blassel in Lyon at the
yes.
conservatory there. So that work is a lot in the classical direction, even though mm-hmm. my approach, I think, is more using my jazz tools, thinking about harmony, thinking about rhythm, thinking, you know, really from, you could say, an analytical point of view, but it's more just a fooling around point of view. Just what mm-hmm. what's going on here? What can we change? And realizing how it's not so obvious for a composer to communicate. What are they trying to communicate to us? And what are our options? And what are our responsibilities? And what do we want to do? So I don't do so much classical. I mean, I still have, every year it seems like I have some project. And sometimes I'll, you know, yeah, do orchestral things or chamber music things. It really depends. But that's not my main focus. And that's okay, because I have my own focus.
So you play also some of the classical pieces even in these days?
I mean, it has happened. It doesn't happen so much now, but yeah, I do. I mean, what I often do when I play classical pieces now, I think, is I still tend to make them my own. Like if I'm playing Bach, then I'll, because I think, yeah, because for me, it makes more sense to want to be able to involve improvisation and to do really what I have in the moment. So in my concerts, I'll play Bach and I'll play Purcell, but more as a jumping off place to go somewhere else. I've also played a while ago with a flute player, we did the Mozart concerto. We did with improvised cadenzas in a jazz style.
Wow, that's fantastic.
This worked really well. It was really nice, actually. It was really exciting. But the last time I did it, I thought that the real way to play the Mozart would be to improvise the whole concerto, not to just play the cadenzas, but to maybe play bits of the Mozart harp part, or maybe not. And the orchestra would do their part, their job, and mm-hmm. I would just react to it. That would be the best thing to do. Yeah.
And Park, I will just maybe surprise you later on, but now let's make a little introduction, an intermission, because we have our winner of the guest of the quizzes. I'm so sorry. I'm too tired. I'm so sorry. My voice is flying away. No, we have a winner of the quizzes, which we had during the June. And we have Maria today with us. So I will bring her in because she will ask you questions. So welcome, Maria.
Hello.
Hi, Maria.
Hi.
Nice to see you.
It's very nice to meet you again.
Nice to meet you. Nice to see you.
Hello.
I think we're in the same room. We have the same color wall.
Well, it's pink, actually, but probably, yes. It seems so.
Maria, you can ask two questions to Park. I will be on the screen, so I will leave you alone, and I'm looking forward for the questions.
Thank you,
Jana. Well, thank you for your time. And let me tell you, my question was even formulated exactly the same as Jana has just asked you. Mm-hmm. What is going on in your head when you're improvising? So I had to think about something else. Mm-hmm. And immediately, one question popped to my mind. In the preparation to this interview, I was watching some videos of yours on your YouTube channel, and I came across the video where you collaborate with a dancer and with two harps, with Delta and your Lyon and Healy, and it's just amazing. I mean, I cannot do probably 10% of what you do on a classical harp, but to be doing this on two harps simultaneously, how do you do that? Do you calculate your every step in your head, or what do you do?
No, I don't.
How it comes?
No, but I think it's like, I mean, I usually don't play with two harps because I think it's, because it's kind of like a magic trick, and people find it. Yeah. I'm happy that you found it impressive. I think, it's not difficult at all. To be honest, okay. You have all the skills. You get the problem. I mean, the problem is always having the idea, and if you after this, if you, I mean, the only thing you have to have is you have to have two harps, otherwise it doesn't work.
But yeah, naturally.
Then, because we're, I mean, our two, I'm not, I only have two hands. So one hand is playing the right hand, the harp, and the other one's playing the other harp. And this is no different than us playing two hands and one harp. There's no difference. The only difference, and so that's why I usually don't do it if I, because I'm afraid that I always worry that it's cheating in a way, that it's manipulating the audience, which I feel bad saying because you liked it. So that's, then the question is, so people are happy. But in that case, with the Delta, I think it makes sense because suddenly we have a lever harp situation and I wanted to have certain chords. And I also think that the Delta has a different sound than the, it was a rainbow actually, than the Salvi.
Oh, rainbow, so, yes.
So, and yes, I admit there was a little bit of a show because I wanted to stand, and also because I just started playing around with the Delta, so I wanted to find a way to put it into a show right away just to see what would happen. And so because it was with this acrobat dancer with his, with his ring, I thought that was...
Yes, with the ring.
For the visual. But really, I mean, no, I mean, you have to try it. If you find a different, you know, if you have a second harp, you'll see it's the same. And I don't calculate because I realized that for improvisation, especially like there, I wasn't playing a piece. I was just improvising something. I was
playing with texture. That's why I asked.
So it doesn't matter what notes I play. It matters about rhythm and it matters about, you know, fullness and close together. Any kind of differences I can make, loud, soft, far apart, close together, fast, not fast. But I like the fact that you think that I think about it in advance because then we're making really But I don't. I just play around. I'm just playing.
Well, to be honest, I think I attended your live concert on the World Harp Congress some years ago. And well, it wasn't mentioned here, but I'm pretty sure that was in Geneva.
Oh, yes, I was in Geneva.
And I, as Jana just said, I was absolutely striking and I listened with my mouth open. So thank you. So my second question actually is a bit far from harp world, but in terms of inspiration, we sometimes use our hobbies and things that we do, well, something else, not musical. Do you have something like that?
Did I use for inspiration?
Yes, for inspiration that is not music, but something in the world in general, like in nature or something that, in life.
Yeah, let's see. I mean, I have things that I do that, I think there's always, what I find is in the things I do in music always seem to have a counterpart outside of my musical things I do. And the things I do that are outside of music tend to always come into the musical side of things because the way I see the world is a musician. So I'm constantly interpreting the world through those lenses and playing around with the world through those lenses. So I can give you an example. One of my sort of hobbies is that I'm very proud of, but is I'm a volunteer firefighter in our town. Even though I also think I'm not such a great volunteer firefighter because not for 10 years, but my skill set, the things that I can do well, tend to not be so involved with, I mean, firefighting. Like in our town, like the people who are farmers who deal, because firemen deal with pumps and water, basically.
Yes.
So if you're a farmer, you also deal with pumps and water. So then your skill sets are kind of aligned. If you're a policeman, you're dealing with, you know, interacting with people and giving orders and following. They have the same kind of skill sets, and mine are not that, which is one of the things that I like about it. At the same time, I found myself, I was asked by the big chief to play for the meeting, and for this then I wrote, I composed a march for the firemen because they needed a march, because they asked me if I could play a march as people walked in with the flag, and so but they didn't have a march, so I thought, well, I'll write a march for them. So many times my role inside that hobby of mine, even though it's a very serious hobby.
yes, too serious to be a hobby, actually.
Well, there are never any fires here. I think it's just more that I realize that the music and life all go together. You know, when I'm walking my dog in Switzerland, this is one of the games I like to play, is that all the license plates of the cars are just numbers. And so if you could take these numbers, then you can map a C major scale onto them, then they all become melodies. And so there's melodies for every car. And so I find myself thinking about this. We're thinking about rhythm as I'm walking you know, and there's always something to think about. So in that sense, yeah, everything I'm doing has a corollary to the musical bit in a way.
Yeah, so it's all intertwined.
Yeah. I think this is sort of normal.
Well, yes, of course. But for example, when I go fishing, I don't think about music, but maybe you had something like that, which totally frees you from this, and then you somehow submerge into music again, and you think, oh, that's connected somehow.
Well, I mean, I guess I can think about, sometimes it happens when I walk my dog. Sometimes I go and say, like, okay, today I'm going to read this thing on my phone, and I think about these things, and I have a program. And sometimes I decide not to do that because I want to allow space for somebody to come in. So I can totally see that with fishing. Although you have to say with fishing, you're also dealing with, you know, gut, perhaps, I don't know, what kind of nylon filament. You're still dealing with strings.
True.
So I guess maybe that does happen for me when I'm walking around. But otherwise, I think that everything I do somehow has a link to music somehow.
To live in music in the moment. That's great. Thank you.
Thank you, really nice to talk to you.
Thank you.
Nice for me as well.
Thank you for great questions, Maria. And also,
thank you, Jana.
It was mentioned that really Park was performing in Vancouver, in Geneva. Yeah. And then
I missed it. Probably, yeah.
And Maria, where are you calling
this
from?
I remember.
Where are you?
Russia, Yekaterinburg.
Great.
Yeah. So greetings from Russia. Hot Russia.
Is it cold? No.
It is hot, really, really hot. It's 30 degrees centigrade.
Okay.
For us, it's really terrible. Thank you
very much, Maria. Take care of yourself. All my best wishes and greetings to your city.
Thank you, Jana, and thank you so much, Park. So bye-bye.
Bye. Well, that's a nice idea. Like, you said that as me a guest, but I wasn't sure what that was going to be.
Yeah, so that's how it works. And I must say, when I hear, like, also my questions to you, I feel like I must look like a fool comparing what you everything have in your mind, because it's really absolutely, for me, you're Einstein, the harp Einstein. You are really, as it was said by Miriam as well, you are a computer and you are thinking like a computer, which is so different for us, maybe not for many of that, but certainly for me as a harp player who is playing really the music. But I'm not too much thinking like a computer, that I would be able to really in advance imagine what exactly the pedals are going to be, unless I really teach them and learn them by myself, you know, so that I know that here I would need to push the F sharp, here I would need to push, but I also do the order by myself when I will push them. You probably push them right at the moment when you need them, right?
Yeah, but usually I do that, unless you can't for some reason. So in some situations I might pre-program the pedal, but when I'm playing, I'm not thinking ahead of what I'm going to play. I'm really reacting, I'm really sculpting, and even though it's very nice that you think I'm Einstein of the harp, I don't think it's really true. I think it's really that I think it's like a magic trick, and that because of the things that I'm, the tools that I use are similar to the tools you use, but different enough so that you think they're magical. But I promise you, you have a harp right there. Don't you want to try to do this three
times? No.
Do you ever use multiple pedals at the same time or never? That was one of my questions for you. Never. But you know it exists, this idea.
Yeah, of course I do. But I never dared to try it even, because I was afraid that I will always lose. I will always make mistakes.
But when did you first become aware that that was a possibility? Have you always known there was a possibility?
I think that I saw it somewhere, that someone has done it, because they needed to push more pedals at one moment, so they did it like especially the men, so that they have bigger foot, so that they really push the two pedals together, but never three. That I have seen only for the first time today.
Because that's the thing, I was starting to tell you how I discovered this multiple pedal thing, but I forgot, I got off the topic. It's important to say that I discovered, meaning that no one told me and that I figured it out. But then once I started doing it, I realized that I wasn't the first person to discover this. It's been around for hundreds of years. And I mean, Salzeba talks about it, but I don't think he really used it. Renier uses it in the dances, in her transcription of the dances. When I first learned the dances, I thought, oh, whoever edited this edition doesn't know anything about the harp, because obviously you can't play two pedals at once. And it was Renier. And then looking back at the single action harp, I mean, Boxa and Nadim and all these guys, they were using three pedals all the time. That's how they would make a diminished chord. And yes, of course, the single action harp is different. It has lighter action, pedal action, and a little bit different. But women were playing pedal harps and using these three pedals. I mean, it might be a shoe situation.
Exactly. That's what I think also, because as we usually wear the heels, then it's very difficult to push them. But as a man has the flat shoe, maybe that's why it's more seen by the men when they are doing it. But can you when you push the two or three pedals, you push them down and back immediately, or you push them only down? Can you just push them up as well? You don't put them into
the natural to flat?
However, from natural to sharp or to flat, or
I mean, usually when I'm playing them, 90% of the time I'm dealing with natural and sharp. So I just press them down and then they come straight up, or I hold them down and I let them come up, because it's much faster this way. Because if you have to push them up and then push them down, this is two movements. But into sharp and then release, it's one movement. That's how you can play very, very fast chromatically things. But yeah, I do move them up. You can move them up. It's a little trickier. It takes more. And that's one of my, we can start to talk about this now. One of my big projects right now, not just in COVID, but for the last 5 years, I don't know if I told you that I'm doing this thesis at Trinity Laban. Do you know about this?
Yeah, you wrote me,
Okay, good. Yeah, that's the thing with people who are doing a thesis. It only takes like 10 seconds before they start talking about their thesis. But and for me, it's all about pedals. Surprise, surprise. But as part of this thesis work, I've composed 10 etudes, pedal etudes, using different pedal techniques, using the 3-2 stuff, using, there's a piece that has every half of the notes are from pedal slides, and the whole melody is fed into pedal slides. And one of them is using, I can show you, using this to take the three pedals, acquire the three, and put them out, and then to take the three and bring them back down like that. So grabbing the three, which is, I mean, and doing it in time, which is not always so, and doing it also with the right foot. And I find, you know, it's luckily for me now it's working, but many times what happens, you'll get the outer two like this and not the middle one, which is because the middle one, the shoe is a little bit taller. But it's really about, and when I'm in my thesis, I'm talking about the kinesthetic approach to the pedals, to really feeling, and now I can, through my shoe, I can feel those three pedals, and I know I have them. Oh, yes, I do. And that you can go down, you can go, once you have it, you can sort of go anywhere, even there.
I think it's crazy.
But I mean, it's really the question of what can the pedals do? What is pedal technique? Then you realize there's a lot of things you can do.
It's amazing. Even that you can push like only the two pedals and the middle one, it's not pushed. I just can't believe it. It's just like crazy for me.
It's really on purpose. Usually I want to do all three. But I mean, but it's true, that'd be ideal, is if you had a sensibility that you could grab the D and the B and knowingly leave the C. I mean, that's what with Spohr, I mean, and Boxa talks about this as well, that when they were doing their, they might fold up the pedal so that they could do like this.
Oh.
But I don't find that, and then Boxa says, just don't worry about it, just push down the three. But
honestly, when do you need to push all these three from one side together? When it can be used? In Boxa, yeah.
Because it's tuned in a different way, the harp. So with the single action harp tuned in E flat, if they wanted to play a very quick F sharp diminished chord, or E flat diminished, whatever, they would have E flat. So I'll show you. It won't sound like, so my harp is not tuned in E flat, but so this would be, so it's E flat, F, G, and A flat. So if they press this down,
Then they have E flat, F sharp, and A natural. And that would give them a diminished chord.
So I see.
Many times they'll do, I mean, almost every time they're doing it, you'd see it, it's that.
I see. Wow. That's actually very clever. But do you think that they had to find out by themselves, or it was really, they were taught like that by the lessons for the harp? Because it would interest me, because otherwise it is really a mathematic, you know, which you need to have in your mind. Or it, if it's, it was, but I don't know if you can know.
Well, I don't, but then I think that in a way, because the people who were reading these treatises about, they were also composing and making their own music. And so they were looking, so in a way it was the same path that I was on, where I was making my own music and trying to find a solution to solve a problem. And yeah, so I think that's a big difference.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure that it was also for me that they, because you can also do it with this by just, I mean, it's the same exact thing. You could just press down F sharp and then A natural on the single action, that'd be an A natural. But it takes too long. So that's no different than when I was saying, well, I can do this, but that's too long. Maybe this would be less dangerous. And so they may have at one point had that same idea and pressed down A natural. And
even you don't need the other pedal, right? Even you don't need the one pedal, you just better.
If you're doing the diminished chord, no, then you have the E flat, F sharp, A, C.
But so, I have one wonderful comment here. I should buy a foot extension.
Yeah. See, this is one of the things I know it's a joke, but the thing about two pedals and three pedals is that the only person who has an excuse is somebody whose feet are shorter than this. So there is, it's not that, there, this. If your foot is shorter than this, then you need a foot extension. But then but it's no. I mean, I think that the high heel thing is, that's a valid excuse. If you, life is choices and consequences. So if you want to have high heeled shoes, then it's true. It will be complicated for you to use two and three pedals at the same time. For me, for the double action pedal harp, the three at one time is very, very useful because it gives you that right foot whole tone scale. That's one. The left foot, I don't ever use three pedals at once, basically, except, I had one etude about that, as I told you, because I was playing Giant Steps, and for that you needed to change very quickly the pedal, so I needed to have the three. But yeah, no, I'm sorry, no foot extension.
Park, I have now one thing, and you would not believe me because it doesn't. I would not believe it. When we were starting and we were talking about the. Your way to come to make the jazz music, and that you went through the classical playing, and you were saying that you usually use the classical harp music for making some improvisation. And I, at that moment, I thought, I will ask you to make improvisation on the Mozart. And then you started by yourself to talk about Mozart, that you want to do the improvisation one day. I said, like, well, if I will now tell it, you will not believe that it was really my idea to ask you for the Mozart. Would you like to do a little improvisation for us of Mozart concerto?
Yeah. All right. really put me on the spot. That's fine. Like this. So what about thank you.
Bravo. Thank you so much. Well, really.
It's very interesting, actually. When I was playing, I realized, because I don't have a problem to just play. I can just play for a long time. But if I was attacking a piece like a Mozart, what I would want to do is I want to have a sort of a menu of themes in my head to not go off into my own situation. So that's why I thought, that's what I do when I'm playing a classical piece, is I make sure I have a clear idea of a roadmap of possible directions, possible themes that I might want to interact with, because of what I'm just playing. So anyway, that was a very interesting realization for me. I'm going to write that down.
No, it's fantastic. I have seen, of course, and on your also on your videos on your YouTube, that you made the improvisation on Debussy dances, which I heard also once in life, which is amazing also, because it suddenly you realize that really there is so many harmonies in the Debussy dances which so evocate you to make the jazz on it. So it is really amazing that you can do it like that. And yeah, everybody
it
should.
It wasn't like that. It took a lot of work. Actually, that was a big project, because I had this idea with Debussy. Because for the first time for the American Harp Society Congress, they decided, or conference, they were going to have a jazz concert. It was in Detroit for the opening concert. And so I wanted to do something really special so that I'll learn some piece that I've never learned. Like, again, it was like giant steps. Like, I'll play some really complicated jazz piece that I've always wanted to play, but never figured out how to do it. And then I realized that the audience were harp players who didn't necessarily listen to jazz. And so if I played something that was really complicated for me, that it might not be useful for them. And then I realized, I thought, well, maybe these harpists who are listening never listen to jazz. So they don't really have the experience of, you know, tracing the theme. Because when you're playing a jazz standard, you're interacting with the theme of the standard, whether or not you actually show it. Usually you do show it, and then you go somewhere else and you come back. But not necessarily. Depending if it's a really well-known theme, the autumn leaves or something, you may barely interact with it. So then I thought, wait a minute, everyone in that room who's a harpist is going to know the Debussy dances, in most of them in a deep way. So if I take... find a way to deal with the Debussy dances, then it's going to be relevant for them. And so then they can have this experience of listening to a jazz standard in a way, coming from the harp. Mm-hmm. But then how to do that? That was a big question, because how do I organize it? And then for that, then I ended up just listening to it and sort of picking out themes. It's the same thing with the Mozart, actually. Picking out themes and making a basic roadmap. So I decided I had to make some kind of decision. So I decided I was going to follow the piece straight through with some pauses in the middle to go wherever I wanted to go. And then it was like a big band chart. A big band chart is fixed with solos in the middle. But because I'm not a big band, I had much more freedom along this chart. But it took me a long time. It was really a stressful thing, because I knew I was going to do it. It was a strong idea that I had to do, but I wasn't sure how it was going to work. I thought maybe I was going to have a Rite of Spring situation where people were going like, boo, boo, or maybe I was going to have finally a slow clap. Maybe. But it was actually went very well.
It's impressive. You should all see it. I wanted to post it, but it's about 10 minutes long. And I said, like, well, it will be really cut too many videos. So that's why I said, like, better I will post it after our interview, the link, so that everybody can see it also. And I have here also from Miriam, I have a question. If you would do also the improvisation of the jazz, I mean, the Ravel Septet.
Well, it's funny because I have a project with Fabrice Pierre. I don't know how we had this idea. I think he had the idea that we realized that a fun concert would be as a duo that he would play sort of standard harp repertoire, the harp repertoire that is really important to him, like Berio, for example, and that I would improvise at the same time. And we thought, wow, it'd be a great concert because neither of us has to practice, because he can just play and then I'll just play. And it turns out actually it was also a lot of work. So we did the Ravel. And that was kind of complicated, because I had to provide, you know, all the chamber music part of it, and then figure out how to make it so it makes sense. It wouldn't just be this static transcription. But like the Berio works very nice. It's the Quenza, because I decided that for this I would set up a rhythm section, basically of a walking bass lines and some chords, and that his lines would become like improvisations. So he's playing the set thing, and I'm making his set thing become improvisation. So Miriam, yes, it's been done, but I think it's easier with two harps.
Yes, and when we have Miriam here on the messages, I just want to say, I found also a video where Miriam is singing.
Oh, yes.
Play. And I wanted to put it there, but I will put it only when Miriam will be as a guest, because I wanted to show that she's also not only a harp player, but also as a singer. I was so impressed about that. How did come this project together? What was that?
Oh, this is Miriam's idea. It was for Arl, I think. But it was just that one time, and she had this idea. But I think a better story is when I first met Miriam at the World Harp Congress in Washington State, in Tacoma.
In Tacoma.
Yeah, for me, that is one of the America's, because we're good friends for a long time. But we met there, and she was, she told me that she was coming to New York a few days after the Congress was over. And so we agreed that we'd meet. I think she was going to stay. I was living at Daphne Hellman's house, the Heartless Daphne Hellman. There it is. And so she was going to, I think, also stay there. But we hadn't really planned anything. And after the conference was over, I went scuba diving with a friend of mine who lives near Washington. And then I got on a plane. The plane was packed, this overnight flight. And I was in the very last row of the plane. There was one seat next to me. And I looked up, and here was Miriam walking down the plane. She had not only the same, we didn't coordinate anything. So not only was this exact same flight, but then she happened to be in the seat next to me. So I think that this is also, I mean, because of course we had this long trip. So this also helped our friendship. But anyway,
destiny is amazing. And did you do this concert, which is recorded on the video, only once, or did you make more concerts when
for the moment, only the once, but she says right there, Marielle Nordman asked her to do it.
Yes, indeed. Yeah, it was meant, she wrote it here. Yeah, Marielle asked her. Yeah. So, and we have here also a message from Marisa Robles again. Great. Which is so lovely of her to be with us. So, we just found one foot in the Debussy dances. You can do that with the three pedals, this very difficult passage where it's so many pedals. Is there any trick which you can help to use the three pedals on each side?
But the thing is, my life is like a magic show, so I sort of cheat it's going to make the whole thing less. But of course, it's all diminished scales, diminished chords.
So I change it a little bit. My solo version of it.
So in the original one, which I don't play anymore because it. I guess the real answer is that because I'm not so worried about pedal noise, and I'm not so worried about other noise because I can hide it a little bit with all the other stuff that's going on.
Do you use the three pedals to push, or
no,
do you?
I use the three pedals. No. No, I don't. I just use only sharps.
We don't see the pedals. Can we see the pedals?
Sorry, yeah. So I do this in mine, and I do it with an octave here. So it's just this.
It seems to be easier. It seems to be easier than we do the like original version. That's interesting.
Yeah.
Have you ever thought to print out and published your versions of some kind of improvisations?
You mean in general or for the Debussy?
Yeah, general, Debussy in general.
I have published some things. You can find them on my website, or you can find them in various places. I haven't done the Debussy yet. It's always hard for me to write out improvisations because one of the advantages of improvisations is that they're ephemeral. They just disappear. So, you find this in recording also, that you want to find something that really holds together. But if you're choosing an improvisation, I always think it'd be easy to write out an arrangement. I'll just arrange, I'll just do a solo and I'll write it down and I'll get rich. But then when I start to write out the improvisation, it very easily becomes heavy. And so it's hard to keep it with the same sort of, because the improvisation itself is an image of what's going on in my head or in the room, or like it's all the things that are happening are sort of impacting on this, what's being played. Mm-hmm. And whereas if I write it down, then it can easily gets heavy. But yeah, I do some, and I want to do more because I think it's a nice idea. And I also think that, I mean, the other problem I have is I think the harpists should do their own. At the same time, I admit that if I write out my possible solution for this improvisation, that it can also inspire a harpist and show them one possible thing, and that they could then change it and do, you know, something else with it. This is also mm-hmm. possible. But yes, the answer is yes. Sometimes yes, and I'd like to do more.
There is a request from Miriam, if you can really print the page, the participation arrangements. For sure, it would be nice to find it out on anywhere to be print. Yeah.
Maria Elena Bovia in Milan is writing a book, or I think it's a book about the Debussy dances, and she asked me to give her that, which I haven't done yet, but I'm supposed to do it now. So if you find her book, then you'll find this thing. Or if you email me, I can also send you.
Super, super great. Park, because you are not playing only alone, you are sometimes playing also in some group, like with a trio, or I mean, in a trio group. I have a video of you playing with the double bass and percussions. So I would like to bring it in, and you can talk about it later on so that we can know who was playing with you. So let's now... Yes, bravo.
No, I forgot about that. So nice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where was it and who was it?
So, okay, so this was a bass player named Dino Contenti and a drummer named Gigi Biocati. And Dino was one of my first jazz friends in Europe when I moved here, when I became coming here much more often. And it's also one of the first bass players who I felt completely free with, because he's this really zen guy, and you can just change what you want. You can play, you can change the key, you just go, you think, oh, I'll just turn left here. And he'll go along, and there's never any problem. And that was, for me, to play with other people, that was always the problem, I thought. Because I found that when I would be playing with bass, or drums is a little bit different, because you don't have this harmonic question. Mm-hmm. But with bass players, I never felt comfortable just going wherever I wanted, and which meant that it would be this static thing. We'd make a chart, and it would be this form and this many. I really didn't find it fun. But with Dino, we could just do what we want. And Gigi is the same, and so it's okay. And this was for a festival, festival in Bourg-Lorraine, outside of Paris. And it was nice, because that was an idea based on the theme, the Darth Vader theme from Star Wars. I had the idea just before that concert. We just decided to play it. Because I was thinking about how the TV show Starsky and Hutch, it has a different theme song in the States and in France. And in the French version, it has lyrics. And all the French-speaking people seem to know this Starsky and Hutch. And there's a whole story. Whereas the American version, the one that I remember watching sometimes, it doesn't. It's just this funky disco kind of thing. There's no words. There's no Starsky and Hutch. And so then I was thinking about, the Darth Vader theme. And I thought, well, maybe there could be a song, and you could put words to this one, like with Starsky and Hutch. And so that's where the Darth Vader, in fact, the only words I added were Darth Vader. There's just two words, but still. And I added this B section. So yeah, that was it. That was the piece. But actually, and it's funny to see that, because knowing that was the first time I really played it, I think I had a basic idea of how I wanted to go, but I hadn't ever really worked it out, because we need to just do it live. And now we've played it, a bunch of times. So now it has a form, and I know when it's going to end and know where it's going to go, probably. But at that moment, I can see myself, it's nice to see myself thinking, because we happen to have a video crew for that. We hired, we decided we're going to a beautiful theater that let's be responsible and get some nice footage for your show many years later.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know. it's really great. This, I will show also. I have some pictures from that time, but I have to come to that, because I want to show really everything what I have here. That's the sea park.
Oh my God.
Years ago.
Where is that? Well, that was for a wedding. Oh my God.
I have no idea. Yeah. But you certainly did play also classical piece, probably.
Actually, they want me to play Clair de Lune, and I ended up playing an improvised version of Clair de Lune, I didn't have time, or wasn't organized to get my Clair de Lune together, so I started off, and also because when you're playing for a wedding, I think it was a time thing, that I wanted to be flexible for the timing so I could fit it into the space of the ceremony. But it's funny, that wedding was for a friend of mine named Nick Harvey, who was a composer, who writes mostly for TV, but he also does some musical theater kinds of things in London. And we're doing a project right now. That's one of the COVID projects, because we've been friends. We first met through Daphne Hellman at the Fringe Club in Hong Kong. He was in Hong Kong and I was in Hong Kong because of Daphne. And we would hang out in this club called the Fringe Club and jam together. We were friends since then. But we always thought it'd be nice to do a project together. So finally, we, during this time, have been writing an album, mostly for TV. It's a TV music to be used for film and television stuff. But so it's a different kind of music, because it has a lot of space where words could go, where dialogue could go. But actually, somebody doesn't have that much space. Somehow it got complicated. So I'd play some things and send them to him, and then he'd cut them up and put them together and send them back to me. And then I'd play some more things on top, and he'd go back, and or he'd throw in a MIDI patch and say, can you make this happen on the harp? It's really interesting.
Fantastic.
Interesting. No one can hear it right now, but still, it's actually on my website. If you go to harplab.net, there's a page that shows these tracks.
Absolutely, everybody should look for this. I will ask once more for the exact name of your webpage. So I will write it down for the banners. Here I have the pictures again. Miss Miriam.
Yeah.
Where was that? Because it's also maybe some years ago.
This I don't know. I don't know where this was.
No, but anyway.
I don't know that sweater, but I don't know that.
And I have here also a picture that...
Oh, that's my town. That's in here in Vallejo. It's Ulsan. This is the first jazz harp festival. Jazz harp camp.
You play always outside?
No, that was just the final concert. So we actually had the classes were in our house, in our barn. And it was actually nice because the harpists would come and some would camp out in our field and some stayed with people in the town. And so this is a very small town with 220, actually it's a little more, it's 240.
How many harpists comes to this festival usually?
How many harps? Mm-hmm. I mean, usually sort of maximum 10, so it's around 10 people. And I've only done it four times, I think, so far. We did it two times in a row and that was too much. And then, because the idea was that many times in my teaching, it's a little bit different now with the teaching I'm doing in Milan, but the other kinds of teaching I'm doing, especially at that time I was teaching in London, and it was for harpists who didn't necessarily want to study jazz harp, that they, in London, they have to take my class. Also in Lausanne, it's the same. So I wanted to, and when I go to a harp festival and I teach a jazz class, it's always a little bit, it has to be friendly. It has to be like the circus, like there's a little bit of, I have to make it not too hard. We can't go too deep or too fast. And so that I wanted to have a camp. I wanted to have a program where it was really with people who were true believers. And we could really go as deep as we possibly could for 1 week and also have fun. And so we did. And so I made this happen. And we did this two times in a row. And then it was too much, so we took some time off. And we did it again. And I think we did it, maybe it's five times now. I don't know. And actually, this is another one of my COVID projects as I did. And that's what you were talking about at the beginning, that I made a virtual version of this. And this came, and this is really directly a COVID situation, because the teaching I'm doing in Milan, it's a master's program, a one-year master's. It's called New Language for Harps. The idea is it's not a jazz harp program, although it uses a lot of jazz harp elements to help harpists to do a project, basically, and talk about these different things. And usually I'd be going back and forth to Milan to work with the new students, but we couldn't, obviously, because everything's closed down. So for the first time, we had all the group classes offline or online, and I realized it was possible. It took sort of five group classes to go really far to explore each of the things I wanted to talk about. I mean, then it's months and years of work to fit it into your fingers and your feet and your playing and your heart. But to talk about it in the way I like to talk about these subjects, like the right left foot stuff. About 5 days. So I just said I was going to make a virtual jazz harp camp. And so I just last 2 weeks ago, I think I finished the first one. And it was five sessions over 3 weeks.
Wow.
Watching about this, and if people are interested, you can all find it on my website. I'll do it again, I think, because I think it's really useful. In the end, then there's so many things you can learn about online anyway. There's so much jazz information online. That's one of the great things about being alive right now, is there's all you have to have the ideas of what you want to learn. But at the same time, since I've been thinking about this for a long time, I kind of like my approach. I kind of like the way that I, for me at least, and I think that maybe for other people it's also useful. Anyway, so that photo there is from the very first jazz harp camp, and the concert we gave then at the end for the whole village, and the village was really a special moment. Now, also because in our village, in non-COVID times, it's kind of like in Asterix, that we have these parties. In summertime, every week there's a party at somebody's house, an outside party. And so this was time to coincide with that. So the whole village would come to this concert, and then we had a big party. And because the harpists had been in the village for the whole week, there was a lot of interaction between them. And so it was really, it's really nice.
That's cool. And you play at this concert, at the final concert, you play pieces which you learn during the lessons, or something what you improvise during that time?
It was a little bit of everything. Some people played pieces that they learned during the week or pieces that they had prepared before. There was a piece that we played together, which is probably what that photo actually is. And I mean, we went as far as we could in the week, and then we just saw, the day of the concert, we figured out what can we possibly do. It's because this can be the problem when you have a workshop, is some, because workshops, either they have a concert at the end or they don't. And I like when there isn't one, because if there is a concert at the end, then suddenly the whole week or whatever it is feels like a rehearsal for that concert. And it sort of puts a different focus on how we're going to learn. At the same time, it's nice when there is a concert, because then this gives an urgency to the whole thing. And it also is nice for the people to realize that they've learned a lot of things and to test them out in a real situation.
Mm-hmm.
But in this case, it wasn't because I was able to do it the way I wanted to do it. It wasn't a stressful thing. So we did whatever we could do. And I didn't really worry about it too much. Just the day of the concert. Okay, now what can we do? What can we possibly play?
Mm-hmm. So it's really very spontaneous.
Yeah.
And the people are bringing their own instruments, or you provide the instruments for them?
It's a whole mix. I mean, some people were coming from the States, some people were coming. And again, this has only happened 5 times, so it hasn't, or for however many times it is. So it's different every year. But that's one of the behind the scenes worries. We get some harps from Salvi's been helpful with harps, and then local harpists have provided harps sometimes. And then the ideal is people drive and they bring their own harp. So far, it's always sort of worked out. And I have a couple harps here, and so we try to make it work. The disaster would be if everyone flew from Hawaii and didn't bring.
I know.
It would be very complicated. But it's been always been okay, because of course it means a lot of people coming from Europe, and then we had last time it was Hong Kong and a couple from the States, and then it was France and Germany, the UK, so and Switzerland.
That's super. And now it comes my question: when you play this harp, which you use now, it's classical harp, or is it an electroacoustic harp, or
a rainbow? So it has the pickups behind every string. Yeah, it's nice. I like it. Yeah. But you know this harp, right? This is what I'm using. But what I like about it is that I feel like the acoustic sound is also really good, I think.
Mm-hmm,
I play both Salvi and Lionel Healy, and but I think that with Salvi, this is not a bad harp. Anyway, it's the one I have right now, so that's what I use.
Yeah, and when you have classical harp, do you add some kind of amplification, or do you use just simply a classical harp when they don't have any amplification?
Well, it depends what I'm doing. If I'm playing, I mean, for me, it's always better for the bass to have a bass which is a little bit more present. So usually when I'm traveling, if I know I'm going to be playing an acoustic harp, then I bring a pickup, small pickup, microphone, which is designed, which is disguised as a pickup, basically, from AKG. Mm-hmm. AKG Micro Mic 3, I think it's called, and I put that on there mostly for the bass. And the disadvantage of that is that it amplifies also the pedals more than this one does.
I see.
And sometimes in some situations it's not possible for whatever reason. So then I'll just play acoustically. But I find it's a lot more work to make the bass really speak, and because I'm using the bass for rhythmic impetus to construct my whole thing, it's just a lot more work.
But you can do sound so big anyway on the classical harp as well, so don't worry. But of course, I understand for your kind of music, it's very important to have the bass. If you don't have a double bass player next to you, of course, yeah.
Yeah, but it's also, I realize it's not about this, it's actually more that I can play softer and have the left sound be the same level. Because if I can play softer, then I can do more subtle things. It's a rhythmic problem, actually. More softly, I can do really subtle things with the rhythm, but if I have to pluck harder to project more, then this changes my rhythmic concept.
I understand. Yeah. So let's now have again music. We have another piece for solo harp, so let's do it now. Thank you. Bravo again, of course.
All these videos are from the same, it was obviously because I'm wearing the same shirt. And the, but there was this really interesting moment because I was given this carte blanche de theater here in our town, not in this town, but the bigger town next door. Valle Osorio-San, which has these 240 people, is 10 minutes from a bigger town called Yverdon-le-Bain, which has 25,000 people and has theaters and gas stations and such. And it was a really strange moment because they, this is embarrassing, because they made a film about me. In this part of Switzerland, they, I'm sorry I brought it up, but just because I was thinking about that, that day was a really special day when I filmed that, because this film that they made was gonna be shown in that theater the one time it was ever shown. And then I was gonna do a concert and I could do whatever I wanted. So I was able to bring in that acrobat and flute player I'm playing with, and Gigi also with painting. We did all these kind of interesting things that I've wanted to do for a long time. But it was really a crazy moment. The idea behind the film was that at one point there was a writer from this area of Switzerland, and they wanted to find some footage of him, and they realized that he'd never been filmed in his lifetime. And so they freaked out and said, we're gonna film all relevant artistic people during their lifetime, which is crazy now because everyone like this, everyone is filmed all the time. So there's no chance that somebody who's doing something perhaps interesting is not going to be filmed during the life. But this thing exists. And then they decided for whatever reason they're going to do it on me. Maybe because for here I'm an immigrant. I came from outside. I have my delightful, strange way of speaking French. And so that day where it was really a stressful, and yeah, it was a completely stressful day because I had to organize the concert with all these different people and the taping, and I was nervous about this film being shown to everyone I knew here, and I had to then take questions afterwards. And it was also a little embarrassing because there are any number of people who would be, you know, useful to have a film made about them.
But the concert is beautiful.
That thing is that when I was playing that, that was the easiest part of the 2 days because I could just play. Anyway.
We are lucky that we have these videos from that concert. Even it was not the easy for you, the dates, but really the concert was fantastic. So we are very happy to have it. So, and I would like to know, Park, as we had already, I think, two people who played the jazz on the interviews, and they were using the loops. Are you using sometimes also, or you are absolutely not a fan of that?
No, I don't use loops. I don't use loops now. And it's not that I'm not a fan of, it's just I don't do it. I don't use so much effects either when I play, because especially when I'm playing solo, I mean, sometimes it happens in some situations I'll use some effects, but I know a lot of, some harpists will go deeply into this. I think that our instrument has enough stuff, enough possibilities. And so for the moment, I'm fine. I also find that when I'm playing, if I'm using effects, I know your question is about looping, but I think it's sort of the same world. If I'm using effects on my right hand and my left hand, I want to have more separation between what's going on, and I feel like I really can control it with the effects. And for the looping thing, I don't know. I mean, I've thought about it. Of course, I've thought about it. I like the idea that playing with a looper would be really good, a good way of getting better rhythm. Which I'm finding also, but if it's a recording project I'm doing now with Nick, I'm thinking a lot. I'm always thinking about rhythm kinds of things. But I know when I played with Rudiger, he used looping a lot in his solo thing. Mm-hmm. But I feel like, I don't know. I don't think it's, for me, it's not really necessary, because I like to, I feel like I'm my own looper, that I can create a pattern. And then I have this idea that the audience holds that in their head somehow, and then I can play something on top. And all I have to do is make a subtle reference to that pattern. Show you. Because people always ask me, they're like, how can you do, oops, I just kicked my camera. How can you play a bass line and chords at the same time, and then a melody at the same time? And the answer, of course, is I don't. Is I might like, but you still hear it somehow. And I think that if I had three hands or four hands, if I could do this, and this, and this, and something else, you know, I think it would be just the same question about making the, writing out improvisations. I think it gets heavy very quickly. So for the looping, I prefer to have virtual looping out of time, to suggest an idea and then have it. I always think about when you're spinning plates on a stick or spinning a basketball on your finger. It takes a lot of energy to get the thing going. Come back to you. But then to keep it spinning only takes a little bit of energy. So if I'm doing a left hand thing or whatever I'm doing, I think that there's a half-life to these ideas. So that's my looping answer. But I don't hate looping. I just heard a looping thing. It was really.
But Park, you only convinced now again that you are really the genius. Yeah. That you are.
Yeah, but this really is an. I assure you, this is a normal thing. I mean, maybe because it could be you're not spending so much time improvising. If you're improvising, then that's what you're doing all the time, and it's more. Maybe the only thing that the only small measures I thought about it. I thought about that it's okay not to play all the things all the time. But thank you. I mean, of course my ego loves when you say, but it's really.
You are the Einstein, as I said, yeah? The harp Einstein. You are, absolutely. We have here also some wonderful comments.
Oh, wow. Hey, Paul.
It's lovely, really. Thank you very much for everyone too. And it's absolutely true. So, Park, as I can go, I hope I can still go through your photos, because I have here also a photo here.
Oh, yeah, great.
What's, probably from the very similar concert, or is it this different concert probably, but what is it, the little harp? Of course, it's very little. Who was playing on the little harp?
That's Rudiger Opperman, but I don't know where that was, because maybe with a drummer? I don't know what we did with drums. Oh, that's so weird.
And the guitar is there as well, yeah.
Deborah's there?
a bass guitar.
Yeah, I don't remember who this would have. Uh-huh, it's so embarrassing. But so Rüdiger, harpist from Alsace, from Germany, he made both the harpies playing there and also the harp behind him, which is also sort of curved to my right. And these both have a special, like a whammy bar. The nut can move, so he can go up and down. I think almost a whole step.
And right.
Basically, his goal was to be Jimi Hendrix. So he built a harp that would allow him to play, do the same thing that a guitar could do. And, yeah.
But I would be interested in if you don't mind what kind of tune you are in, right? It doesn't matter for you if they say it's in E flat major, let's go in E flat major. You have still in your brain, you have the how you will push the pedals. I'm sorry to repeat myself, but you know, maybe you have some tune which you like the best. I mean, some tonality which you like the best to work on, or maybe is there any tonality which you absolutely hate?
No, there's no tonality I actually hate. I think it depends on the situation. When I played with Rüdiger, we'd often play in D because the way his harps were tuned. So that was the defining thing, and that was when we made our CD, the problem was to find a way to balance our D songs with non-D songs so no one would figure out we're always playing in D. I think that when you're playing it, I had this idea where I could share with you guys. One of the things I do for practicing chords is what I call it, is using melodies like Happy Birthday. I think actually Happy Birthday is the ideal thing for this. So, and I'm getting to your question in 1 second, I promise. But if I'm practicing, let's say I was going to practice my minor seventh chord, which I do without a fifth. So I would play then, to there are 12 of them that exist because there are 12 notes. So then I would play Happy Birthday. And then make that the, on top of each of those notes, I would make the minor seventh chord. So, and what this forces you to do is it forces you to think about a couple different things at the same time, to hold in your head the melody, and to think about the chord you're doing and to not freak out. And then you try to do it in time. But the reason I'm telling you this is that I realize that when you're doing, you're only playing how many notes? So 7 different notes with a B flat. So you're missing 5. So then I thought, okay, maybe a smart thing to do would be to play it not starting on C, but starting a tritone away on F sharp. So even though I can do it, I know that when I do this exercise, I have to think differently, I have to think more. So I think it's really about being comfortable, habits in a way. I mean, that keys I tend to play in, and there's, as I was doing it, I was trying to think, oh no, this is not helping this conversation we're having. Again, it's very nice of you to say it, but it's really not, and really it's very generous, but it's really not the situation. But I think that the more you play in a certain keys, the more habits you have, and then eventually it stops you. Then it becomes, the risk is always it becomes in a rut. So sometimes I change the keys of pieces I'm playing I'm sure I can play myself into a corner and choose a key. You know, hubris is everywhere. So I could think, wow, it's all the same because I am so fast. Man, I'll just play in this key. And then I'll think, oh, why did I do that? I was so happy in D minor. So,
but did you?
There's no difference. I'm just playing different music at a different approach, a slightly different approach.
Mm-hmm.
So and I assure you, it's a magic trick. That's all it is.
But I think what I said, I just will say it once more. Einstein can do it for sure. Yeah.
On my side, I'll say that magic trick. It is a magic trick, but magic tricks also take a lot of practice and thinking. So I'm not. It's not something that I'm cheating. It's just that things that I do might look complicated to somebody with a different point of view, but it's not complicated. It's the same. It's exactly the same, but different.
For me, it is totally complicated, but yeah. But Park, did I miss something? You have a birthday today? No, hopefully not.
No, I just like that song because when I'm working with students, no.
No, okay.
Because that's a song that because we all know Happy Birthday, and so it's a song that we
Of course. But you know who has a birthday today? Nancy Allen.
No,
really? Ellen has a birthday, so I So maybe you can play happy birthday for her.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, wow. Oh. I'll put it here.
I hope you are with us. Happy birthday! Yeah, thank you so much, Park. I just wanted to go through one more pictures. Here is you in the college.
Yeah, in New York, graduation from Juilliard. Well, that's crazy that was online with Stella Berg, a football player.
Yeah, so it's really, so it's actually, you were studying with Nancy, right?
Yeah, for one summer at Aspen, and then 3 years in New York. And that was great. I really loved
it. I can imagine.
Of course. Yeah.
Absolutely. So that's really a wonderful connection. And here is it your daughter?
No, it's actually the same person from the previous photo, also Stella, who lived in the hall, and we were good friends.
How lovely.
I'm wearing a Fantastics t-shirt. Wow, nice.
And you have a dog, but here you are with a cat. To tell me.
Wow. And I don't know whose cat that is. That might also be Stella's cat. I have no idea which cat.
But these are really nice. But you have a dog. Is he, she living with you or?
Yes, he is living with us. Leo. Actually, he has another harp connection, my dog, because Leo's mother's owner's neighbor is a harpist, Patsy Seddon, who is I think the director for the Edinburgh Harp Festival, and that's a direct connection to one of your previous guests, Deborah Henson Conant, because I met Patsy the first time I went to Europe was with the New York Harp Ensemble with Arsène van Wurzel to record an album in Hungary. And I was really excited the first time I was going to go to Europe, of course. And I was talking to Deborah at a festival, and I said, "Yeah, I'm going to Europe in November." And she said, "Me too. I'm also going to Europe in November." And "Where are you going?" "I'm going to Hungary." She said, "I'm going to Edinburgh for the wedding." And I thought, "Wow, maybe you should come. Maybe you should come meet me." And I looked at a map, and it turns out on a map, if you look between Hungary and Scotland, it's only this far. If you look on the right kind of map. And so it was before internet. It was really so naive. And so I did this recording, and then I got on a train. And I remember getting at some point the trains. So I just had an itinerary. I'm like, it's funny. There's water in between. Of course, there's. Wait, do I have a boat ticket? And then I had to get to a certain club before it closed because Deborah was playing there that night, and she. Was my ride was there. We were staying with John Hoare of Pilgrim Harps at his house. So if I had to get there, and this was before cell phones. So I mean, I'm sure there would have been a solution, but I remember it being very stressful. And then I went to this wedding, which was a wedding at the house of a harp maker, of a Scottish harp, the Clarsach maker, Jack Yule, now living in Colorado. But and so I met many harpists at that wedding. It was this famous wedding, this party that lasted for 3 days, including Patsy, who is, as I said, my dog's mom's owner's neighbor. Mm-hmm. So anyway, yes, Leo is his name. He lives with us.
And what's the kind of dog? I mean, is it big one?
Big and small, difficult and easy. These are all relative questions. He is a medium-sized dog. He's half Labrador, so big, mm-hmm. but also half Spaniel. His parents were also both half Spaniel and half Labrador. So he's a medium. Actually, that would be the photo I should have shown you, but I don't have. We were going to a fancy hotel for our wedding anniversary, and we were going to take Leo with us. And when I looked online to find out a hotel that took dogs, mm-hmm. and I did. But then my wife said, you should call and make sure. So I called and I said, yeah, you took dogs. I said, yes, yes, yes. Is he a big dog or a small dog? He's really a medium dog. But if a hotel is asking me if it's a big dog or a small dog, I'm going to say he's a small dog because I don't want them to say that he can't come. And he's not a big dog. He's in between. But it turns out the reason they were asking was not because whether or not he was admitted, but they had, because it was a fancy hotel, they had a little dog bed for him. And it was a little dog bed because he's a small dog. And so there's a photo, which I'm looking for you. But of him, and it's basically just the upper half of his body is lying on this bed because he somehow understood it was for him, but it's like so uncomfortable and sort of ridiculous. But he's a medium-sized dog. He's a great dog. He's
lovely. And congratulations to your anniversary, of course. To the
it's in February, so
far away. So congratulations. Here we have also photos when you were a student.
Also Interlaken. This is the same. Wow, Interlaken Arts National Music Camp in Michigan. And that was the second photo you showed. It was the same group. And I think this is we had a. What do you call it when you're singing? I'm losing it. When you're this Japanese tradition, you sing along to words. What is this called? Anyway, we had this playback singing competition.
And so doing, that was karaoke.
Karaoke. No. Thank you. Yes, this is our karaoke thing. I'm holding a music stand that because I was playing the trombone, so I was using this folding music stand as my fake trombone.
And oh, that's lovely.
So, yeah.
So you are, where are you now? I can't see you.
So I am, again, the second from the left.
Second from the left, sitting.
Sitting. So there's a tall guy standing, and then I'm next to him sitting.
Yeah. Oh, fantastic. So how old have you been? About?
I would have been 13, 12 or 13.
Mm. Here's also a great photo of probably advertisement.
But yeah. Huh. Yeah. With the lining Healy harp. Yeah, I don't know what that is. That it could have been, looks like those lights there, but that, no idea. But
it's great photo. Here's one also, there is also Miriam, and there.
Gargiulas, I think.
In Gargiulas, indeed, it looks like.
Wow, yeah, wow, look at that, Miriam. Wow, Enrique.
Yeah, you can actually see the names there are there, Chef's mom. Yeah, of course, yeah. And here's also a nice couple of people with you.
Maria, Maria. Yeah, wow, this
Maria
is
Lisa.
And yeah.
And tell me, are you going for the holidays with the harp?
But this is actually, that's a very nice photo. It looks fantastic. This is the Lake of Neuchâtel. This is the lake just near our house, kind of near our house. And this is for the jazz harp camp. The first couple times we did it, we had a barbecue and jam session at the lake. So we brought the cajon and I think that's one of the harp. That's not my harp. Somebody brought this harp there.
I wish to be there. It must be amazing.
Yeah, really great. I want to go. That's an exceptional photo.
That's really great. And here we have also great people together with you.
Mildred, yeah.
Isabel Perran and Milda Agazarian.
Yes. That was fun.
Very fun. And here I found this. Who painted this for you?
Oh, I don't remember. I'm sorry. That's not very old. But no, I don't know who drew this, but I remember this. If you
doesn't matter. I thought maybe that you know.
No, then I'd like to know. I don't know who wrote this.
But it's really great. It's absolutely fantastic pen and painting.
Position.
Indeed. By the way, this was my also question. Did you find your position by yourself, or did someone told you that you should not sit like that, or have you always sit like that?
No, I mean, that's a long discussion. I think I sit like this because, I mean, now I know that it also has become kind of a habit, so I also try to not do this. But sometimes when I'm moving lots of pedals at the same time, it's useful to hold the harp down with my chin, so that's one of the things that I think comes to it. And also, I think it was easy for me to feel like I was really deeply listening when my chin was really, let me see. So if I'm like this, I can, let me see, put the pedals on. So I can really hold on to,
understand. Yeah,
because otherwise I can move around somehow. But I don't need to. That's what I realized later on, is I don't need to have it like this. I can also just play the harp. But I think but also many times I'm playing Prêt à la Table with the bass. And so this also can be unnatural to be sort of stretched around like this. So if I'm here, I can go much lower. And so, I mean, as I
understand,
because there is no bad position, body position, it's just how you are within that. So the problem can be if I collapse and am not really present. But I think if I'm really sort of bent at the hip and have a good direction, then...
But it's you. It's you. It is you. So it's just only if someone ever, when you were studying, if you were playing like that already at that time and you were playing...
No. This happened. I think it really happened once I started doing a lot of bass lines really low on the harp, and then more comfortable to do this. And then because I was listening in a different way, I think I started listening in a slightly different way, then that I started to associate that with concentration. And I don't have to be that way. I also, the same thing, when I play with my eyes closed, because it's very comfortable for me to play with my eyes closed. And sometimes a part of me that I'm not proud of me thinks, wow, maybe that looks impressive because my eyes are... And that's crazy. And so now I try to play with my eyes open usually, and I try to really look at the audience, because I realize I was in a way I'm hiding if I play with my eyes closed. But I still do sometimes because it's really comfortable to just be in my head. So those two things, I think, my position. So I realize I can really be present up in here, and but it's true that it's a long time I played like that. So I also worry sometimes about my jaw. I think if I have the harp against my jaw, wow, that could really maybe not be so great for my teeth to have.
No, harp really
against my jaw. So the answer is yes. I think about that a lot. I don't really think about that, but I think about that, from time to time.
But it's also because you sit really low. You are tall. You sit low, so of course, then you have also more contact with the. It's you. It's absolutely your. I cannot imagine that you would sit differently. But it's just like only, it would not fit together with your wonderful playing. So, perfect.
When I saw one of the, there was a video, but it looks sometimes like my head is cut off and just pasted on the side of the harp. I'm wearing black and I'm against a black background. It really looks a little bit disembodied.
Like theater, you mean? I have here also some other pictures, again with Mirja Agazanyan and also Kyla Panda.
Yeah. This would have been, because that's in the Duke, or in the recital hall. I think so. That would have been the open day for the Royal Academy. Although that's an electric harp. Yeah, that would have been from Hollywood Music. The electric
And here, this very special place, is it inside, outside?
There, this is just next to me. I'm looking at it right now. I don't know which one it was.
But you have music, so do you teach with the music the people?
It depends. That may have been the let's see. Well, we see the music in front of us, but who knows? I mean, it could have, if we're looking at it, if we're playing a standard, then they'll have a chart for the standard there. And if we're looking at maybe with a handout. So yeah, that could be music.
If you have any rules from which you teach the people. So, or if you only show them and they have to think by themselves.
I have rules. I have four rules. And I have, yeah, I have a list of things that I think are useful to explore. And yeah, so I have, no, it's not just do what I do or like, no, I think I try to show them. It depends what we're talking about. If we're talking about a piece that they're playing that they are proposing, then I'll react to that as with a classical lesson. That I should see what do I hear and to be really as present as I can possibly be to give some kind of useful feedback, or feedback at least, that hopefully it's useful. But yeah, if we're working about a harmonic bass or the technical stuff, then I have a list of things I'd like them to be able to do because I think they're useful. And yeah. And different ways that I tend to get into that. There is method to my madness.
Yeah. Because of course I can imagine that when you teach, you might have some printed music, not music, but really the rules for the students so that they can follow, you know, so that maybe that's what I was thinking, that you might give to the students some kind of your rules, which they can follow by playing so that they...
Yeah, well, the rules are more oral. I mean, I can tell you rule number four, for example, which is the most important rule. They're all the most important rule. The rule number four is don't panic, which is a very deep rule. Rule number one is don't put your pedals in the notch, which I already told you. I mean, that's really the rule like this. Rule number two, don't play the fifth. The rule number three is a little more complicated, but it's so it's, for me, it's more, I think, yeah, those four, I call them the rules, but I really go to the bottom of the basis of all the stuff I do, that to not put your pedal in the notch. This means you're playing sharps or often you're playing sharps, and it also changes the way that you're interacting with your pedals, and it will in mean you're involving in harmonics. And so there's lots of things with a, you know, seemingly simple idea. Don't put your pedals in the notch. Yeah. It's not so simple. I mean, it's not difficult or hard. Again, it's just that there's many things that are implied within that one simple rule. But
I'm sure that now all the harpists will try to push the pedal the way how you say, because we all want to try it, certainly.
The thing is, with them not putting the pedal in the notch, it's not just for jazz playing. I think that if for the people who are listening, if you're thinking about this, it's very useful also for classical repertoire. I think it's good sometimes to park a pedal in the notch and leave it there. But many times if you have just a back and forth accidental, you don't need to, and maybe nobody does this, but I that's not true. I've definitely seen harpists moving it into the notch and then moving it right back out. And the longer the time is between the second motion, the less there is chance that they're just going to hold it down. But it's really useful. And this doubles your, at least your number of pedal possibilities. So,
yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Here we have a wonderful picture with the tractor as well.
Yeah.
Is it in your camp?
It's again in the camp. This is, we were having one of our neighbors has a bread oven, a pizza oven, and he makes bread.
You have so many really amazing, special, very unique photos. Like, for example, this one, it's also very unique. This one, of course, we all know.
Oh, crazy. Yeah. No, what was that? That was Tony Healy did this event in Shanghai, I think it was.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And so I was there. I was editing the jury with my assistant and Anna, and I did a concert. So, but because it was in China, they have often enormous lighted things. So that, you know, my ego really enjoyed that.
You deserve it. You deserve it. But the photos when you were doing this photo, you know, did you? I mean, the harp was in the grass. Or was it like, you know, I always think about the harp, how, because it's always in the very different places than we are usually taking the pictures. So,
no, I mean, of course, I think about the harp as well. Now that photo was a long time ago, but I have to believe that I put down some kind of covering and it wasn't.
Because we cannot see it now, but there is the harp was really sitting like staying on the grass. But it's an amazing, really special, absolutely unique photo, which. Everybody.
Well, it's funny because I know that photo really well because I was there. And so
But now I see it sort of with your eyes, like, yeah, it's kind of a nice photo. And it looks really strange holding onto the thing there. But it was really, I mean, we did a lot of different photos, and it was just a logical string. I think I remember that it was a little bit, it wasn't about the touching the ground, it was just, is the heart going to be stable enough? Because that's mm-hmm. often the problem. But I think that it's leaning against that fence, and there's a chain link fence behind that. So it's mm-hmm. So again, it's a magic trick.
Yeah. And here I have, what is this? Also in your place?
No, this is a concert somewhere, but where? That's Rüdiger Offermann again behind with the harp he made.
Uh-huh.
And this is a Liney Healy harp. So, but it's not a sound system I know. It could have been on our tour, one of our tours in California or around there.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yeah, that would make sense, but I don't know where that was.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. And here is also...
Well, is that, did you find this on the internet as well?
What does the message mean?
Yeah, I just see the top of it, but I remember this, that I met, I can't remember who the harpist was, but a harpist who thought that I was dead, which made me and so, and they bought a CD. Sorry.
Here's a wonderful photo from Shanghai again.
Yeah, right. Again, that was the same event. And Niall and Anna. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and this great photo. Yeah, that was one of the first times I went to China. That was really
uh-huh.
amazing. Uh-huh. So,
super yeah. nice. Here's again another group yeah. photo from the tour.
Right.
Yeah.
Jason, it was funny because we were in school together. I first met him in Arizona, the University of Arizona.
With Jason?
Yeah. And then, so strange. He stayed in Arizona for after graduation. He stayed for a long time. And in fact, he's lived in Arizona longer than I have, even though
oh.
Which is funny because I'm like an Arizona guy. Like, actually, he's more Arizonian than I am because he lived there longer.
It's this. The world is small. Absolutely, the world is small. Here is also a photo. I just could not find what was that because there is a Lion Healy wall behind you. What was this? Do you remember?
Oh, this is the 150th, the anniversary of.
All right, in Chicago.
Oh, yeah, with Kim.
6 years ago, 2014.
That's right.
Yeah.
Wow. That was
and here is
Gabriella. Oh, nice. In my own wake. This is a Trinity Lab, and it must be. I don't remember what mm-hmm. this was, but maybe it was a classmate, it was a collab. Let's see, do I know everybody? I honestly don't remember what this was for, but
certainly you were quite often in Italy, as I have seen from the photos which I found.
That was Italy then. Okay, that was for the Saluzzo. Yeah, mm-hmm. but Gabriella, we do this. Can I see the photo again? Is it possible?
Yeah, sure.
Yes, of course it's not in Trinity. That's in Saluzzo. Yes, we with Gabriella we do this class. That's why I recognize people in the photo, but not so well, because I would go to work with them just for those few days. And some of them come uh-huh. back several times. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I do this class in September, end of August, beginning of September every year.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully that will happen this year.
Well, there's also another photo of you.
Yes. With the beard. Yeah, and it's nice. And in this town, in Saluzzo, there's so much gelato. Ah, yeah.
Also with Marie-Pierre Langlamé.
Yeah, because we were playing with her with Berlin.
Uh-huh.
Playing, but yeah, so that's like a proof that sometimes I do some classical things.
Yes, I can see, indeed. And here comes the photos from my festival, which I have arranged.
Right, it's, of course.
Let's go.
Fun, wow. That was after the concert, I think, in that cool club.
Indeed.
Yeah.
Indeed.
Well, do you remember the name of that club? It was a really interesting place.
Now it comes out of my mind. My goodness, this is really crazy. I should know because I learned it. My goodness, someone should bring the city. Of course, I know. This is the place.
This spaceship. Oh yeah, masterclass and yeah, that was really fun.
I will search for it later because it makes me crazy when I cannot remember now. But of course, I.
Of course, yeah.
Here's also another group picture.
How long was that, this festival?
5 years ago.
Wow.
2015. It's flying so fast. Time. It's really, oh gosh. It was the Czech, no, Český Těšín. Oh my goodness. I can't remember now, really. But I know. I know, absolutely. Okay. Crazy me, really. But here's probably.
Yeah, with Enzo, what's his last name? Yeah, he plays with two harps often, but I think he's doing it because they're tuned differently, and he has those dampers on his harps.
Yeah. I'm just trying to find out, because it makes me really crazy.
I look like a tenor. Like I could be like a Wagnerian tenor.
Yeah, he was a singer.
No, he's a harp player.
Harpist also.
Yeah.
Okay. And here is also a photo from
Sylvain. This is in Gabriela's house with Sylvain and Nicole. Wow. Mm. That was not long ago. Yeah.
Concertus. I will find it out because it makes me crazy when I can't find out where was it. Wait a second. I will find out. Mm. Because it was a Zhdjar nad Sázavou. Yeah, it was the city.
Was my town.
Yeah, of course. That's why I could not remember either. So here we have another poster. What was this?
Oh, right. This is in Korea. And actually, Kiwa Lee, who had a comment there. Hi, Kiwa. I don't know if you're still watching. She has this great club in Banjul, called Banjul in the middle of Seoul. And I played a concert. I don't know what year it was, but yeah.
And we can see again
New York and on the Queensboro Bridge, which was right from Nancy Allen's house. From Daphne Hellman's house.
That's what I want to say. Again, a very special photo of yours.
Yeah, and actually that was for Lion and Healy. They wanted me to have a photo for to promote their harp. And I realized at that point that this photo I had, it's not so interesting, but I had to take that twice. We had to take the harp there twice because I realized when I played, I never smiled. so it wasn't so fun. So I was like, I'll just go and play and we'll take a photo. And I looked at it like, wow, that's so unhappy. And so in this particular photo, so with me trying to figure out how to smile at the same time. And also you can't see it because there's a P in front of it, but there was a bicycle player. There's a bicyclist who was going down the bike path right in between my legs and the harp. Right where the P is, and so that was sort of not so useful either. But that was the best photo we had. Yeah.
And I asked because I wanted to find out, and I could not find out the really very special photo where you are on the bike and on your side car was the harp.
Yeah, for my first CD.
And I know that I am sure that all the harpists know it, but I could not find it on the internet, and it was really. I wanted to post it and I could not, but it was made the photo at the same time as this one.
I don't know. I don't think at the same time, but the same general time within the same 5-year period. Now, that photo was made for the first. It was for my first CD of Overdressed Lady Guy. But it was an idea I'd had, just as I was playing, as I was gigging around New York, I was spending a lot of time playing, background music, and spending a lot of time to think. And that was one of the ideas I had. That would be a funny idea to have a harp in a sidecar. And so we went to the local Harley Davidson dealership, and they had, it's actually not a Harley Davidson, it's an Indian motorcycle. And what's funny is that I used this Style 12 that I got from Deborah Henson Conant, which was, and the people, I think the motorcycle was worth more than the harp. So everyone was worried about their instrument. I was worried about my 12, and they were worried about their motorcycle. And anyway, yeah, it was a nice photo.
It was really a very special one, and I will try still to search because on your Facebook I could not find it. So I will still search if I will not have a luck still during the interview to find it. But here is also a photo from Japan. Of course, there is a lot of fans always when you are having the concert and they are coming for the.
Strange. Or is it really Japan or is it?
I think it was in Japan. It looks, I don't know, it looks like in Japan. Or maybe it's in Hong Kong. Maybe it's in Hong Kong.
I've been to Japan recently. And I've never been to Hong Kong Japan as a solo, doing my own show. I was there for a couple months with the Fantastics. We did a fantastic tour in 30 or so different cities. And then I was there for this singer project where I just went for a few days. That's always one of the things that frustrated me. I mean, although now with traveling, who knows how it'll be, but I always wanted to find a way to get back to Japan because there are so many harpists in Japan that, and they also have a huge jazz culture, but it's not so obvious, you know. So anyway, but this is for sure in Hong Kong.
Fantastic. I just, I will have some surprise. Wait a second. Well, we will have come here with this. This is also.
This was in Italy.
And here we come. I found it. This is the one.
Oh, yes. Yeah, the motorcycle actually has a flat tire. So we had to always pump it up before taking the photo.
That's, I can't imagine.
With Photoshop, this would be very easy now, I think. But
absolutely. Yeah, but I was just, when I saw these photos for the first time, I thought, like, poor harp, how did you manage that the harp did not fall down?
Yeah, but it's a small harp. It's a 12, which is a kid's harp in a way, really small, like a troubadour. And so it can fit in there without a problem. So that's again a magic trick.
Yeah, exactly, because it doesn't look like it looks like really big harp, absolutely big harp. It's a gorgeous piece.
This is the idea about playing bass lines and chords and melody at the same time is that just like when I'm playing things, the looping question, that when I'm playing, I want the audience to do part of the work for me. And but this, you did part of the work for me also. You saw that harp and you thought it was a big harp. So you it could have been just part of a harp, but it was a 12.
That's right, yeah. And here we have picture from Italy again.
Yeah, that's right. I don't remember what this was. I remember that concert, but and that theater. Wow.
It's a beautiful hall.
Yeah.
And here is the picture from Tacoma, probably.
Right. Yeah.
1996. Yeah. So a long time ago, but you have not changed a bit.
That's when Over Just Like I first came out, because I remember I was selling it at that conference.
And here is also a great group of people.
Oh, wow! Fantastic. Oh,
and here it's also with Sasha.
Yeah. I don't know where this is, but maybe in Paris. This is in Paris. At a concert together.
And this I found. Can you tell me, is it something special or just?
Yes, it's very special. Well, actually, I have this group which is a little bit not so active right now, but called the Dada String Quartet, which is harp, flute, and percussion. And so the flute player is in black there, and the drummer, percussionist, is in front with the colored shirt. And we were at this festival in France, not to play, but just to go and check it out, just sort of see what they were doing. We were thinking that maybe we could do something there later on. And this was a really amazing show that we saw, where it was an outdoor show. How to explain this? You had these stands, like in an arena, made out of wood. And you sat on these stands, and then a guy came without saying anything. He started taking out big planks of wood and building this thing and handing, and he found a way to integrate the audience by taking, you know, handing somebody a piece of wood, and step by step, finally, the audience became the actors. And in fact, it turns out that these stands that we've been sitting in, the seats, were also made of the same kinds of planks. And so they all just, this whole thing disappeared and became this huge construction.
Amazing.
So I always think it's interesting. How do you involve the audience? I mean, how do people on stage or get them to, because I'm always a little bit nervous to, if I'm in the audience and somebody, you can come up and be part of it, even though I have no problem to be in front of an audience, but that's because when I'm going as myself, but to how do you change the role from being a member of the audience to being on stage? And this moment was really amazing at how I was able to seamlessly get the people to participate in a joyful, easy way.
That's very interesting.
That Dada String Quartet was really a nice group. That's where we did lots of projects with it, just sort of long improvisation, timed improvisations, where we'd play, it was called the Dada String Quartet because it was a joke, because that would be funny, because we're not a quartet. And so because we're not, we didn't really know anything about the Dada movement. And it turns out that the whole approach was a very Dadaist thing to do. But it also turns out that when we started, it was the 100th anniversary of the Dada art movement. which was too bad for us because it made us look like we were doing it on purpose, that we were, you know, being calculating and making this group to profit from it being the 100th anniversary. But in fact, we weren't, because we, it was already the 100th, it was too late to really take advantage of it. And so it was just, but because of, we did do a project where we had films, Dada films from that time, from the, you know, 1917 on, but mostly from the 20s. And we had 53 minutes of film, just nonstop silent film. And then we would just improvise without looking at the film. So the audience would look at the film and they would listen to the music and they would make the connection. And we wouldn't necessarily know what was going on. We'd seen the film, so we knew sort of what was going to happen. But it, the music we played, we would just play. And then at some point, the room would be dark, so we'd realize the film was over. Anyway, yeah, that was the Dada String Quartet.
Great. And here we have also, you got some prize. You have prize Harpo Marx?
Yeah, this, I'm sorry, I don't remember the name of this town. That's the same harpist, Enzo, whose last name I'm blanking on. Oh, I'm so sorry, Enzo. It's a small town in Italy where, if I'm correct, Victor Salvi's ancestors, family comes from. And it's a town which has a very strong harp tradition of a special kind of Italian harp that I'm not an expert on. But the harp is really important in this town. And so I came with a trio, the bass and drummer you saw earlier, and they gave me this award, which was very nice.
That's touching. That's really great. Yeah. And here it's a great poster. You play in the room with the flute.
So this is the flute player from the Dada String Quartet. In fact, we sometimes have as the Dada String Quartet, we play as a duo. So this is two thirds of a quartet. And this was a concert we did in Spain. But actually, we had a very nice project this last Christmas. We made a Christmas CD, and then the idea was we did a series of concerts in churches, but they were 15-minute concerts. Because I had this idea that in this region of Switzerland, there are many, many small towns. In fact, there's a whole movement to try to combine the small towns because they're just too many. And every small town has their own town council and their mayor, and it takes a lot of energy. So, but every town, most towns have a church as well. And nothing happens. I mean, these churches are often empty because they're small anyway, I thought it'd be funny, interesting to do a concert in every church the same day, and just to do a 5-minute concert, then run to the next church and do another 5-minute at Christmas time. Mm-hmm. Because as a kid, I used to do this with the harp ensemble. We used to go and do little miniature concert tours the same day. We'd play three short concerts somewhere, and I really liked that. So that idea became instead that we did six concerts the same afternoon. Each concert was 20 minutes, and we had a bus, a school bus, the Swiss equivalent, that would go from concert to concert. And so people in these small towns could go to their church and have a very short concert, because I also thought that at Christmas time, there's so many things going on that no one, it's harder to have time necessarily for a concert. So this way, everyone has 20 minutes, so you could have your little 20-minute concert next, you know, down the street from you. Or if you wanted to, you could get on the bus and go on tour with us and go from concert to concert. So it was called Caravan Noel. And that was with Violette, this flute player. And it was really, and also for me, because when I was in New York all the time, then I was doing lots of freelancing, you know, gigs like people do in New York, playing in hotels, playing at Christmas time. I played a million parties all the time. Every day I was playing all the time. And now I don't do that. Now, often in December, it's a little bit slower because there's not so much. So I tend not to do, and I sort of miss playing those kinds of concerts. So this Caravan Noel was also a way for me to get my fix of playing, you know, Christmas carols in an improvised way, and have a miniature tour. So anyway.
Super. So what's for this year for the Christmas? Do you plan something?
Yeah, I think we're going to try to do it again. I mean, it depends how things work out, of course, but we'll do it again, also with the bus and in a slightly different region around. But yeah, it was amazing because we also had the people who were inside the bus decorate the bus. We had, you know, lights and Christmas balls, and it was really bang. And what's nice also is in this, if you show up to a concert with 40 people, a church which holds 60 people or sometimes 30 people, then you're guaranteed to have a full house every time.
Absolutely.
So just running around. Yeah, it was really a nice concert. It worked very well.
That's super great idea. Here I have photos also. This is probably with the flutist, which we have seen before.
Yes. And I'm sorry, I'm blanking on the names, but this harpist, Clotilde, from Brittany. The festival, the poster you saw is from this festival we played. Uh-huh. Concert together. We had one piece together we played.
Here is also what kind of instrument he play?
Erhu. This is Guogan. Erhu is a Chinese violin kind mm-hmm. of thing that has two strings. And he's a virtuoso player. His father was a virtuoso player. He's really amazing. He plays. He can make it sound like a classical violin playing classical violin repertoire. And also does the traditional Chinese stuff, and he improvises as well. And so this was thanks to the World Harp Congress in Hong Kong, because he was friends with Danu. So she had this idea that we could do something together. So we did that, and then we just did a tour in China and Hong Kong last September, I think, or October. And we made a couple of CDs together, and it's really nice. He's really...
That's amazing. And this is also some award?
Oh, yes. I think this is at the Hong Kong airport because they have a concert series. And I received...
At the airport.
It was really... at the end of the World Harp Congress in Hong Kong. So...
Wow.
But then Deborah also played there. And because we played there, we received this award. But the funny thing about that, what was really great about it, is that when I left Hong Kong after the World Harp Congress, I took a train from Hong Kong to the airport. And this is the most amazing. On the back of the train, on the cushions of the train, they had advertising. And in the whole car was advertising for this concert series, because it was they were promoting their own concert series. And so, among others, I had my picture. And I'm like, oh my God, my picture's on every seat in this car. I felt so, it was really surreal. And not because I love Hong Kong. I always have a great time being in Hong Kong.
Mm-hmm. That's fantastic.
With your photo on every page, I mean, it was really an amazing thing. But that was at the Hong Kong airport.
That's fantastic. Here's some historical photo again.
Yeah, this is a group, a harp ensemble we had in New York called Harps 4. Which didn't last too long, but with March Fitz.
It's really nice. And here's another advertisement for
in Hong Kong in September with there's Guogan and Gigi, the same drummer from before. What I like about this photo of me is that if you look, go back to this photo if you don't mind.
Sure.
There's a guy named Bill Holden who's standing just behind my left hand. So I think it looks like I have six fingers.
Oh, yeah.
And also an enormous left hand. Forget about having a big foot. That's the secret. It's just having an enormous hand.
It's true. I have not realized that it looks like you have six fingers. That's true. And here is the trio we heard on the video, right?
Yeah, exactly. And this is just a press photo that we made.
Mm-hmm. Again, beautiful. And here's the photo you sent me.
Ah, yes. Okay. Yeah. This is a photo. I think it's just useful because it shows me playing the harp. But this is taken by Rudiger, actually. And it was just actually in his barn, so completely staged. But I like this photo.
It's really nice. Yeah, indeed. And this is also another photo.
Yeah, this is as Maria said with the. But although it's a bit playing with the delta, because I was trying to figure out how to incorporate it into my play.
Mm-hmm.
So I decided where it would be to be standing and then to use the rainbow for some harmony ideas.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And here is a photo from Hong Kong.
Yeah, I don't remember, but yeah. Looking at the shirt, that could easily be Hong Kong.
Yeah, indeed. And here is also from Parks Dickney Jazz Harp.
That was in Hong Kong. That was a few years before that, with all these kids playing on these harpsicles. Then we played these together, and then there was a pianist, I can't remember his name, but and then there was a singer, two singers. It was organized by Angela Yao. That was really nice.
It's really super. And here I have also one photo of two of us. Nice.
That was in Saluzzo.
Yeah.
Wow, your hair. Nice.
Indeed. Also, it's really, the time flies so fast, dear. It's unbelievable, really, that it looks like yesterday. When I saw this picture, I said, like, my goodness, it has been a year. Yeah, it goes so fast. Park, tell me, do you have any, I'm sure you have many funny stories from your trips. Do you have any particular which you really never can forget and that you can really share?
Wow, I don't know. What, that's, funny stories that I'm stalling because I don't know what to say. I'm, about the harp, my life with the harp. I mean, like all of us, I think many funny things.
Any story which is really just kind of really absolutely amazing what has happened to you, and it's really part of not a movie, but it's really part of your life.
Well, I mean, probably. But what comes to my mind is just what I find is crazy for me with my life is that I mean, I've already started talking about this a little bit, was that so much of what I do now is based on the fact that I went to that first pop and jazz festival when I was 10. Because at that mm-hmm. festival, I met many different harp players, some of whom are dead now, playing jazz. And mm-hmm. I met Carol McLaughlin, who would become my teacher. I met Deborah Henson mm-hmm. Conan, because we were all in the competition together. I met Daphne Hellman, who would then become my landlady, who, I mean, I lived in her house. And so that was really an important relationship for me. I mean, I lived in her house for 10 years. And because of Daphne, I went to Hong Kong for the first time, Hong Kong and India. And in India is where I met Christine, where I met my wife. And it goes on from there. I mean, Deborah, from meeting Deborah at that harp festival, then meant that I would go to Edinburgh. So my dog also, I mean, if you look, I mean, it's not so unusual in a way because I'm a harp player. And so obviously the harp world, even though the world is small, as we say, so everything is connected, but still, so many things happened just because I happened to be alive at the right time to be able to go to that first festival, and that my parents were willing to take me there, and that they were supportive enough to do that, and my harp teacher happened to, I think, tell them about it, to think that it would have been a useful thing to do. So that's what I think is amazing, is how many events in my life in different chapters, because I think I have these different chapters that actually look like, actually it all goes back to that one weekend, or that one week when I was 10. So it's like a fractal, and it all just goes back to that. Not everything, but a lot of things. It's pretty crazy.
So, and actually, I have, at the beginning, I have not asked the usual question, so I will ask it at the end. Was your parents, any of your parents was a musician, or how did they love the music if they were not musicians?
Well, they weren't musicians. In my father's side of the family, there were many musicians, but he is not a musician. But they definitely liked music, and they definitely supported the idea of me, you know, pursuing music, even if, which was really, I think, laudable, because they didn't necessarily know what that would mean. They don't know necessarily mm-hmm. what a musician's life is or what a musician's career, how that works. But they definitely always supported and helped with, you know, instruments and driving to lessons and paying for lessons and all that. So they were definitely supportive, but they weren't musicians. But it's funny because I'm reading with my niece, we're both reading Harry Potter again for me. And so it seems to me that this question is exactly the same thing in the sorcery world, like that they come from, you know, from a magical family or not a magical family. And how can it be if you, but yeah. In my extended family, everyone's playing piano. My father played piano and plays piano mm-hmm. still.
Mm-hmm. And you have any siblings? Do you have any sibling?
I have two younger brothers, and they both played instruments. One played the harp, they both played piano, and one played violin. But they're not professional musicians. And one's, I think they're both still playing a little bit.
Mm-hmm. And have you ever played together?
We did when we were kids. We were always trotted out to play for the grandparents and so on. So yeah, we have played together, but not for a long time.
But they are in the US now.
One's in Texas and one's in Georgia.
Okay, so far away, but I hope they are safe at the moment.
Yes, I think they're fine. Yeah,
so, good. Park, it was so amazing to have you. I thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. And for
wonderful playing, of course, as well. All the advices and all the great tricks you showed us. And of course, I have still the one video, which we will see at the end. And I think that this is exactly the video which Maria was talking about, that you are playing on two harps. Wow. And it's a video where it's also a very... very artistry, because there is the dancer who use a circle, which is
It's a circus. I mean, there's an interaction between dance and circus, it's not so far away, but it's a circus.
It's a beautiful thing. How did it come, this choreography, to do it together?
No, it was just improvised. It was all improvised. We knew how much time we had, and he would do his thing, and we knew how it was going to end because he told me how it was going to end, and so we just played.
It's beautiful. So I'm hoping that everybody will really enjoy it as much as I did when I saw it for the first time. And of course, I'm sure that you enjoyed today's guest and today's star, Park Stigney, for our interview, for really to be with us. And I thank to everybody who wrote beautiful comments and who were with us all these 2.5 hours. And I thanks to Park really for everything, and keep going. I'm so happy that we have such a person in our life. So I'm really looking forward to see you again and hear you in life. So looking forward.
Thank you for doing this project. I think it's really.
Thank you. Thank you, Park. And I really wish you all my best, a lot of health. And I'm looking for new videos and for all new information, your new CD, new projects, and of course your new also some kind of lessons online, which you will do. And I will certainly be looking, and I'm sure that everybody will. So have a great evening. I wish you everybody. And let's now finish with a beautiful video of Park Stigney, our guest today. Have a great evening. Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.